My name is Joshua Austin. I'm a restorative dentist in San Antonio, Texas. And today, my practice inspiration for you is about excelling at the everyday. We're all guilty of going to CE courses and meetings where we learn about the big things. We learn about all on fours, veneer cases, full mouth reconstructions, and then we go back to our office on Monday and we do more everyday dentistry. And I want to get us talking more about everyday dentistry so that we make our days go easier and better. I want you to think about just a regular Tuesday afternoon. You get to the office Tuesday morning, you look at your schedule for the first time, and you see an afternoon that looks like this. And what do you see? Class two restorations back to back to back. MOD, MO, MOD, MO, MOD, MO, MOD, DO, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And what I know when I look at my schedule like this is two things. Number one is my back is gonna hurt at the end of the day. It's a hard day. Number two is my reimbursement for those procedures is the same, if not less, than what it would have been for one indirect procedure. So I know it's gonna be hard and I'm not gonna get paid as much. But direct restorations are a reality in dentistry. It's part of what we do. The ADA Health Policy Institute, in their survey of dental services provided, showed that 75% of restorations done in the United States are direct restorations. So many times we can't just default to doing the easier thing, which is an indirect restoration. We have to do direct restorations. And when we do direct restorations, my least favorite clinical scenario is when we have two interproximal caries on posterior teeth, class twos, back to back. I find it to be an extraordinarily difficult situation for me to manage well. Now, the other thing that's really important for posterior class two restorations is interproximal contact. In fact, I think it's the most underrated part of a restoration. Now look at this restoration. What do you see? You see a molar that was restored, a DO of number 30 that was restored using a Toffelmeyer matrix band. When you tighten that Toffelmeyer matrix, what you get is a straight distal wall that leads to a point contact very high on the tooth. And when that happens, you get a food trap down below that. And when secondary caries happens there, it happens deep and towards the bony crest, and it becomes a nightmare for us to restore. So our restorations need to have good interproximal contacts on them if we want them to have good service and if we want to prevent harder situations, more difficult situations, more expensive situations for the patient. When we have two class twos next to each other, we're presented with a challenge and how we're going to phase that and how we're going to do that inside the appointment. Now in the Seattle Study Club, we talk about phasing treatment a lot, but we're talking about more global phases of treatment, how we're going to space out the treatment. What we don't necessarily talk about is how do we phase treatment actually in the appointment? How do we make things happen in the appointment most efficiently and so that gives us the best clinical results? So when we have two interproximal caries back to back, we're faced with a choice. How do we do this? Well, there's three different ways that we can restore two class twos back to back. One way is to prep one all the way, and then we're gonna fill it all the way. Next, we're gonna prep the second one all the way, and then we're gonna fill the second one. The disadvantage with that is that inevitably, we will gouge, scuff, or otherwise screw up the restoration that we just placed when we pass our burr through it. No matter how careful we are, iatrogenic damage happens. So the disadvantage is we gouge the first restoration when prepping the second one, and now we get an irregular contact pictured here. Patient can never really floss that well. It's always gonna shred floss, trap floss, or not be able to floss, and it's just a difficult situation for the patient. That's not great. Option two is we prep them both together. Makes it a little bit easier. Prep-wise, we eliminate the risk of gouging the first restoration when we prep the second. Now we're gonna fill the first one and then fill the second one. The problem with that is that we inevitably over-contour the first one into the space of the second one, and now we have a very strange contact that's an S-shaped contact that the patient may or may not ever be able to floss. And even if we try to go back and make sure we really refine that first composite, it gets very difficult to not restore that into the space of our second one. So what do we do? How do we handle this situation in a way that gives a nice contact and a nice restoration for the patient, but is expeditious for us? Because these are direct restorations. We have to work quickly to keep the patient's attention, to keep them from from fatiguing and to keep profitable in our practices. And so that's why I think option three works best. We're gonna prep them both at the same time, and we're gonna fill them both almost at the same time. We're gonna fill one before the other end, but we're gonna take a couple of steps of action first to make sure we don't get that over contouring. When we do this, the disadvantage is we must use a sectional matrix, and we really honestly do need a rubber dam. Now I'll give you a little tip as we go through the case to show you how maybe we could get away from using a rubber dam, but I would encourage you to use a rubber dam here. Am I gonna tell you that every restoration I do has a rubber dam on it? Sure, because this is being videoed, absolutely. But we all know that there are situations where in practice, in a regular dentist practice, a rubber dam isn't used. I would say this is a situation where we should go back to using a rubber dam. It only takes a couple minutes to put on, and it's really gonna speed things up as we go through it. This chance, or this method of restoring these teeth gives us the best contact, which I think promotes us for the most success going forward. I don't think you can do these types of restorations without a segmental matrix or a sectional matrix. And in my opinion, one of the best ones on the market is the Garrison 3D Fusion Kit. It's an absolutely great kit, but no matter what, you need to find a kit that works for you, and a sectional segmental matrix is a must for restoring these teeth. I'm gonna show you a case using 3M's Filtek 1 composite. It's a bulk fill composite, which I think gives us some huge advantages in these types of situations. And I think 3M Filtek 1 is amongst the best looking bulk fill composites on the market. Bulk fill composites have a few issues that we want to go over. Number one, the pros of using bulk fill composite are absolutely less time. That means less time isolating, less time that we have to keep the tooth isolated, and greater efficiency for us, which means that we can do more of these and we can stay profitable with these procedures. Fewer layers means less risk avoids. It's a more monolithic restoration, which is where we've gone to in our indirect restorations. So we wanna make a more monolithic composite restoration here, and bulk fill gives us that opportunity. Our curing height is really important because we're asking it to cure composite from the furthest distance away that we've ever asked it to do. So we need to make sure we maintain the health of our curing light. We need to make sure that we pick a curing light that will penetrate deep 4 or 5 millimeters down these materials. And we need to make sure we are following that curing light to make sure it's operating at full efficiency. We gotta use a segmental matrix, as I talked about. We do have fewer shade choices with bulk fill composites, but almost exclusively we're using these types of restorative materials in the posterior, so we don't need the full 36 shade kit with the three different opacities like we would find in other systems. And especially as we start using bulk fills, we tend to overfill them, which leads to increased finish time. So there's a point as you're on the learning curve of using bulk fills where it'll take you about the same amount of time because you overfill it so much that you spend so much more time with your 7404 finishing burr that it's canceled the efficiency that you've picked up by doing bulk fill. But as you get more used to this, that will start to go away over time and you will end up with a much faster result, which is great for you and great for the patient. Here's a situation like I talked about, two big class twos right next to each other. Now this patient is a college student and this patient is actually actively undergoing caries control protocol, caries risk assessment, using different anti-caries medicaments, dentifrices, rinses, things like that to try to control his caries. So direct restorations are not good for him, indirect restorations are not good for him at this moment. We gotta restore these with direct restorations. So after I get these prepped and get these opened, what you will see is two fairly big lesions that have been prepared. And now I have two different segmental matrices in, one for each tooth, one for 12, one for 13, and one sectional ring in between the two. Now at this point, you're going to pick one to fill first. Doesn't really matter which one you do, but you just pick your first one. The other matrix really isn't a matrix at this point. We call it a shepherd matrix at this point. All it's doing is keeping you from over contouring your first composite into the space that you need. Now, I've etched and bonded both of these together because I have a rubber dam on, and I'm gonna do my first increment of composite, which in this case is the distal wall of number 12. Because we're using bulk fill, I can fill that whole wall all together at one time. Now, once that's done, I'm gonna do the rest of the lesion, the occlusal surfaces, the rest of that, and cure that appropriately. So now the first one is almost all the way done. Now is where the real key happens. We're gonna take the ring off and we're gonna slide out the matrix that's on the distal of 12. And we're gonna put the ring right back on. Now, if you haven't used a rubber dam, what will happen at that stage when you take off a ring and take out a segmental matrix? You're gonna get hemorrhage into the area, right? So if you decided not to do a rubber dam for this method, all you would do is do your etch, prime, and bond at separate steps. I wanna do them together to maximize efficiency. That's why I use a rubber dam. So we took off the ring, took out the first matrix, leaving the second matrix behind. We're gonna put the ring back on, make sure that our matrix is contoured and curved the way that we want it, use a burnisher or use a condenser to really shape that matrix to get a great contact. And now we're gonna move on to restoring the second tooth. I'm going to do my inner proximal wall first, like always. In this case, it's the mesial of number 13. I'm gonna cure that. This is with bulk fill composite. So that entire four millimeter increment was all filled at one time. Now, I get the ring off of there because the ring sometimes inevitably ends up in my way. So once the ring is gone, now I really have full access to shape the composite for the occlusal section of this filling. And here we go. Here's the occlusal section done, matrix out of there. And you can see we have some flash on the middle of the buccal and the middle of the lingual. That's where I wanna get my flash. Flash is inevitable with composite restorations. What we wanna do is manage our flash so that it's in a situation and in a spot where we can clean it efficiently and effectively. And in this situation it is. It's much easier to smooth that flash with the 7901 finishing burr where it is here versus interproximally. So this is by design, and this is a huge advantage to using a segmental matrix, is we get flash where we can control it. So now at this point, I'm gonna control my flash, I'm gonna smooth everything, polish everything, and here's our finished restoration. And for a bulk fill material, I think this looks really good. For a distal of 12 and a mesial of 13, and a patient who has other caries issues, this is a great restoration. Currently, still undergoing caries control, and at some point, those teeth will probably get indirect restorations, but for now, a direct restoration is the right choice for him. Now, I think it's really important that we focus on our efficiency in the operatory. Patients don't want to be there. They're uncomfortable. We need to be efficient to get the dentistry done that we need to get done so that we can give the patient the care they need, and so that we can stay efficient. So I challenge you to think about your efficiency while you work, and I think about you, I think that you should work on your efficiency on interproximal restorations, especially back-to-back ones, because those are situations we run into all the time, and it would always help if it was just a little bit easier. Please feel free to contact me at any time. Thank you guys so much.